So, welcome to the Testing Academy 101. This presentation is actually aimed at both people who are testers and know the basic of testing, but it's also aimed at people who do not know what testing is and wish to have a better understanding of what we do and as well to test their own work and their own code. So here we have the prototypical tester. DD who presses the button and the laboratory blows up. Testing can mean many things. We perform tests every day, whether it's we change a light bulb and we wish to see if that light bulb is working properly, or we're testing the food that we're cooking to see that it's essentially what we want. And also to see that what we've just changed is working properly. What is a bug? Bugs are faults in the system, code, documentation, etc. And there are very many cases of failures, and there are many causes for failures in the system. Bugs can be caused by gaps in documentation, lack of understanding of requirements, human error, assumptions, we're all tired, we make mistakes. Defects in the software system or documentation may result in bugs, may result in failures, but not all defects result in failures. When an actual result deviates from the expected result while testing a software application or the product, then it results into a defect. Hence, any deviation from specification in the product is a defect. There are many names for defects: bugs, issue, incident, problem. This is depending on the team you're working, on what you're testing, or on the company itself. When the result of the software application or product does not meet with the end user expectations or the software expectations, then it results into a bug or defect. This defect or bugs occur because of an error in logic or coding, which results into the failure or an unpredictable or unanticipated result. And here we have four examples of very obvious bugs. The first one is, I think, from Assassin's Creed Unity, and the other two are from Skyrim. We can see that this dragon doesn't shoot fire from the end it's supposed to shoot fire from. And we have also a very interesting one from World of Warcraft, where they uploaded a patch containing some fixes and some power-ups for a special new character that can inflict disease. And this disease was transmitted from player to player, killing thousands, millions of players in one night. And there were actually people who stopped playing, and the company lost a lot of money because of it. When we find bugs, one of our key features, one of our key activities that we do here in testing is bug reporting. Issue reporting is incredibly important, because an effective bug report influences the people that read it, influence the code, the quality of the code, and the outcome of the fix. A typical issue contains the following fields, although they may vary from one project to another or from one company to another. We have the issue type. Usually there are many categories of bugs: visual, design, functional, non-functional, specification, even documentation bugs. Summary, this is a short title. Environment, we have here dev stage and production, or pre-production for other teams. Description, usually the description contains the steps to reproduce. This is very important, because the developer that reads the bug reports, it should be able to figure out how to reproduce that bug. Expected versus actual, or observed behavior. This is very important, because if the developer does not know what is wrong, he will not know how to fix it and what to fix. And here people can make assumptions, and the outcome will not be what is expected and what is desired of that product. Attachments, usually screenshots or movies or short clips. Labels, priority, test account credentials, version, and etc. This varies from one team to another here. We have a standard bug submission template that I strongly advise you to follow, even if you're from incidents or even if you're a developer or an account manager or an integration manager. It's very important to follow these certain types and steps because it is very easy then for the person who's fixing it or who's verifying it to know what you're meaning and to know where the problem is so they can properly test it or fix it. We have here a standard ITSQB glossary definition for software testing. This sounds a bit bombastic. It's software testing is a process of executing a program or an application with the intent of finding the software bugs. It can also be stated that the process of validating and verifying that a software program or application or product meets the business and technical requirements that guided its design and development. We have here a difference between validating and verifying. Verifying is simply to see if something does what it's supposed to do. And validating in short terms means if something does what we want it to do. Why is testing important? It's important because the cost of having failures released into a software environment, into a software system can lead to the loss of money, reputation, or in extreme situation, injury or loss of human life. Think of loss of revenue, loss of money, and failures in space programs, in flight control systems, in medical robots, etc. In extreme situations, people have died because of bugs in software. Like, for example, this machine that controlled the intensity of X-ray used in a hospital had some failures, and it caused the death of 4 patients. How much testing is enough testing? When do you stop? You stop when you're told to, you stop when you stop finding bugs, when developers say all issues are fixed. We should take in account that level of risk, including technical, safety, and business risks, as well as project constraints and time, how much time you have for testing, and also budget. Because sometimes some issues are left out because we don't have time and we don't have enough funds to continue testing and continue fixing and retesting them. The role of testing in software development. 1, reduce risk of failures occurring during operation. It will reduce the risk of failure occurring when the user actually uses your system, your program. It will contribute to the quality of the software system because while we are testing, we are finding out where we have problems in our system, we are fixing them, so we are contributing to the improvements of quality in the system. If defects found are corrected before the system is released, proper operational use. We are also measuring the quality of the system in terms of defects found. We can also get conclusions and statistics. Tests may be required to meet contractual or legal compliance requirements or also industry specific standards like ISO. Objectives are software testing. 1, finding defects. 2, gaining confidence about the level of quality. 3, providing information for decision making, for future progress, for future projects. And 4, preventing further defects from happening. Also, if we test and if we perform tests in the first stages of development, we might prevent bugs from reaching a further stage of development where it's very difficult and it is not cost effective to fix them. Testing deliverables. They are the artifacts given to the stakeholders of a software project during the software development lifecycle. Each development phase has its corresponding test deliverables. And they include typical test case documents, test runs, test suites, strategy, test scripts and test data, test results, test reports, defect reports, release note, and so on and so forth. There are a few definitions of software quality, and the following are the aspects of a good quality software product. One, usability. This is the capability of the software to be understood and learned and used and attractive to the user when the user uses it under certain specified conditions, like day-to-day use. Testability is the capability of the software to enable modified software to be tested. How easy do we test it? How easy it is to implement software testing frames and to perform automation, for example. Security. This is the capability of the software to prevent unauthorized access in short terms. Scalability is the capability of the software to be upgraded and to increase loads. And reliability, it's the ability to perform required functions under the stated conditions. Maintainability, the capability of the software to be maintained and update to increase loads, to be modified, to be patched and upgraded, to be enhanced, to make it easier to be adapted to a changed environment. There are a few principles in software testing. One, testing shows presence of defects. Two, exhaustive testing is impossible. We can never test all the combinations, all the paths, everything to ensure that all bugs are found. 100% testing is impossible. Early testing should begin as soon as the first function or unit is ready for code testing, for component testing. Defect clustering is the principle that states that roughly 80% of the effects or bugs come from 20% of the causes. For example, in our sites, most defects are concentrated in areas like register login, deposit, and betting and gambling. Early testing should start as soon as the first component is ready for unit testing. The pesticide paradox. Tests should be redesigned and upgraded because usually when you find a certain type of bugs, the developers will learn and adapt, and they will just not, the same test will not have the same outcome every time you test it. Testing is context dependent. For example, it depends on the project you're testing. Commercial off-the-shelf software will not be tested the same way you will be testing an e-commerce site or, I don't know, a game or a mobile app. And the final one, the absence of errors fallacy, that if the system built is unusable and it does not fulfill the user needs and expectation, then fixing and finding bugs will be useless, it will not help. The fundamental test process implies a few stages, and the first one is test planning and control, where you detect risks, we stabilize the test approach, strategy, resources, and so on. The second stage is analysis and design. Review test bases, documentation, identify test conditions, test cases, evaluate testability and system requirements, set up and also find out what are the tools that are required for testing. Test implementation and execution, and it has two parts. Test implementation is when we develop and prioritize tests. We create test data, test suites, implement and verify the environment we are testing. Test execution, we actually execute the tests, We execute the test suites and test cases. We perform regression testing or confirmation testing, compare test results, and report discrepancies to stakeholders. Evaluating exit criteria and reporting, where we actually try to get conclusion if more tests are needed. We try to write summaries for stakeholders and present them, as well as test closure activities. We check the test deliverables, ensure that the incidents reports are resolved, archive testware, evaluate testing process, and learn lessons. And there are a few testing types: functional, non-functional, structural, and change-related. Functional testing actually tests actions that verify a specific action or function in the code. There are two perspectives: requirement-based and business process-based. Non-functional testing tests the quality characteristic of the component that is tested, such as usability, security, compatibility, recovery, performance, stress, smoke, sanity, and so on. Structural testing is the testing of the structure of the system or component. Change-related testing is usually confirmation or retesting, where we actually verify bugs, as well as regression testing, where we test to see that the new changes have unleashed a new set of bugs, or if new defects are surfacing. Now, what makes up a tester? Testers are usually people with the right mindset for testing. They are curious, they have an attention to details, a complete view of the system from both your end user side and a technical view on the system. And they're able to work with incomplete information, such as documentation that they gather from different people, like in our case, integration managers, account managers, stakeholders, etc. Is organized, does not make assumptions. This is a very big deal, because if a tester makes assumptions about how the system is supposed to work, bugs may be overlooked. We have a part of psychology in testing and a code of ethics. We should start with collaboration rather than battles. We should remind everyone that the common goal is for better quality systems, since testers are kind of viewed like the people who destroy the system, and they tend to have wars and fights between testers and developers. When the developer makes an assumption, the tester tells him, no, you're wrong, and then people need to come in and correct and set the battle between the tester and the developer. So we should always try to be assertive and not to present defects as a way to criticize the developer or the person who made a mistake. Issues should not be presented in a negative view. We should try to communicate them in a neutral, fact-focused way, and always avoid criticize. Software testing best practices. The most important factor is to know your product and know what you're testing. Know it from both end user perspective and technical standpoint. We should always try to learn something about the code and about why we are testing what we are testing, and why does a certain feature need to be implemented, how it will affect further projects and further applications. Communication always is the best thing to do. We should try to communicate with developers and stakeholders as much as we can, learn as much as we can from integration managers, account managers, and project managers. No question is a dumb question. Even if you think something is working as it's supposed to be working, always double check. Always try to ask the project manager or who else is a stakeholder on that project. Also, we should usually test our own work. testers should test their own test cases, test suites to make sure that they test what is supposed to be tested and make sure that the test coverage is as maximum, as best maximum as possible, and always to try to avoid that pesticide paradox that we were talking about earlier, where we won't find as many bugs if we just try to run the same tests over and over again. Also, the best, a very important fact is to always test the quality of your bug incident reports, because that's what actually makes you a good tester. A quality incident report. And the final slide is resources about the ITSQB exam certification, if you are interested. The book about Dorothy Graham on the foundations of software testing. And for everyone who is interested, the ANIS CISATQB certification course that is held here in Bucharest. As well, my name is Mina. I work for the Site Builders team. And for any questions, you can contact me on Skype or email. That's it.